Queen Elizabeth II, the longest reigning monarch in British history, has died, Buckingham Palace has announced. She became queen in 1952 at the age of 25 and spent 70 years on the throne. She had pledged to serve her people, which she fulfilled through a combination of skill and a sense of duty. It was during the Second World War that the then Princess Elizabeth gave her first address to the nation, saying that when peace returned, it will be for us, the children of today, to make the world of tomorrow a better and happier place. She joined the Auxiliary Territorial Service, the first female in the royal family to become a full-time member of the armed forces. On Victory Day in Europe, she appeared on the balcony of Buckingham Palace with her family and Winston Churchill, and later danced on the streets with the crowds, pulling an officer's cap over her eyes so nobody recognized her. In 1947, she married Philip Mountbatten, the wedding helping to lift the post-war gloom of austerity and forging a union that lasted 73 years. News of the death of her father, George VI, in 1952 reached Elizabeth while she was on safari in Kenya. The following year her coronation was held, with hundreds of thousands of people lining the road to Westminster Abbey and more than 2 million watching on television. Her reign began with a six-month tour of the Commonwealth. She believed the institution should move away from empire and become more about friendship and equal rights between nations. She was delighted when her eldest son, Prince Charles, announced his engagement to Lady Diana Spencer, with their wedding in 1981 becoming a global television event, but the breakdown of the relationship, and that of Andrew and Sarah Ferguson, wounded the institution of monarchy, and when Diana was killed in a car crash in Paris in 1977, the Queen faced criticism for remaining at Balmoral with her bereaved grandchildren. When she returned to London, on the eve of Diana's funeral, the Queen gave a personal expression of grief. In 2002, she lost her only sibling, Princess Margaret, and then just 7 weeks later, her mother. Golden Jubilee celebrations, marking 50 years on the throne, were held that year. Support for the monarchy had risen, reaching an all-time high when she became the unexpected star of the opening ceremony of the 2012 London Olympics. But there were more difficult times ahead. Prince Harry and Meghan Markle said a lack of support from the royal family contributed to the decision the couple made to step away from royal duties. And Prince Andrew was removed from his public roles as the scandal that had started with his friendship with convicted sex offender Jeffrey Epstein grew. The COVID pandemic was the biggest global crisis of her long reign. In a rare speech during the first lockdown in 2020, the Queen made it clear that she understood the grief and hardship people were facing, invoking Vera Lynn's wartime classic, "We'll Meet Again."
A year later, she had to deal with the death at 99 of Prince Philip, her husband of seven decades and rock. The Platinum Jubilee in 2022 marked 70 years on the throne, and despite mobility issues she continued with public duties. Kathy Newman looks back at the life of Queen Elizabeth and how Britain transformed during her reign. Rest in peace from the bottom Filipino people heart. Till we meet again.
In a way, I didn't have an apprenticeship. My father died much too young, and so it was all a very sudden kind of taking on and making the best job you can. It's a question of maturing and into something that one's got used to doing, and accepting the fact that here you are and it's your fate, because I think continuity is very important. It is a job for life.
She was the longest serving monarch in British history. For 70 years, Queen Elizabeth was a figurehead for her country and the Commonwealth. She led the church, guided her family through often turbulent times, maintaining her dignity and composure. Her first instinct, always, to perform her duty.
I think she must have been the most successful monarch we've ever had. To have reigned for so many years and to have kept this extraordinary institution going for so long And through such extraordinary changes, there she was, the rock that the people could look up to.
April the 21st, 1926, joy bells rang throughout the empire. The royal union was blessed. Princess Elizabeth was born.
She was born a royal princess, but was not born to be queen. As the elder daughter of the Duke and Duchess of York, she was third in line to the throne. A seemingly idyllic, carefree and sheltered childhood with her younger sister Margaret. But her destiny changed at a stroke when she was just 10. In 1936, her uncle Edward VIII abdicated from the throne in order to marry the divorcee Wallis Simpson.
I have found it impossible to discharge my duties as king without the help and support of the woman I love.
The abdication crisis would remain a powerful influence throughout her life.
Literally overnight, her world changed. Yes, her father was now king, and that certainly wasn't expected, but of course she immediately became his heir, next in line to the throne, and by all accounts, Princess Margaret pipes up, "Oh, so you're going to be queen now?" And Elizabeth said, "Well, yes, one day," and Margaret said, "Poor you." This was dramatic beyond all measure. I mean, this was the end, really, of a carefree childhood.
With Elizabeth educated at home by tutors, the royal family was a cheerful emblem of Britishness as war drew near. It was during the Second World War, Princess Elizabeth gave her very first address to the nation.
God will care for us and give us victory and peace. And when peace comes, remember, it will be for us, the children of today, to make the world of tomorrow a better and happier place. My sister is by my side, and we are both going to say goodnight to you. Come on, Margaret. Good night, children. Good night, and good luck to you all.
During the war, the children were living at Windsor, but the King and Queen stayed at Buckingham Palace.
For the King and his family, war came to shatter the world for a second time. The King was untiring in his efforts to lend encouragement throughout the long years of struggle. He stayed in his capital. His home indeed was a target for the enemy.
The Princess was allowed to join the Auxiliary Territorial Service, the ATS, becoming the first woman in the royal family who was a full-time member of the armed forces.
At an MT training centre, Princess Elizabeth, now a second subaltern in the ATS, has been on a 3 weeks course of instruction.
On Victory Day in Europe, she appeared on the balcony of Buckingham Palace with her family and Winston Churchill.
Today is Victory in Europe Day.
She later danced on the streets with the crowds, pulling an officer's cap over her eyes so that nobody recognised her and Princess Margaret.
Lines of unknown people linking arms and walking down Whitehall. All of us just swept along on a tide of happiness and relief. I think it was one of the most memorable nights of my life.
During that time, she had been writing to a distant cousin, a young naval lieutenant, Prince Philip of Greece.
As a midshipman, he'd taken part in the Battle of Cape Matapan.
She met Philip Mountbatten when she was just 13 years old on a visit to Dartmouth Naval College. His uncle, Lord Mountbatten, encouraged the match. The palace wasn't happy. He had German ancestry, no property, and limited financial means. In July 1947, the engagement was announced.
The royal family and Princess Elizabeth's fiancé have permitted these special film studies to be made in response to the rapidly mounting worldwide interest in the forthcoming royal wedding on the 20th of November in Westminster Abbey. Princess Elizabeth has won a special place in the hearts of the people of this country and of the Dominions.
Their wedding later that year lifted the post-war gloom of austerity.
How they cheered the happy pair when they came out onto the balcony.
Within a year, she gave birth to a son, Charles. Like her, he was brought up by nannies. For a brief period, the princess enjoyed her role as a naval wife, especially when Philip was posted to Malta. But it was cut short by family tragedy.
Once again, he seemed to be on his way back to health, and when he went to London Airport to say farewell to the princess and the Duke, he appeared to be better than he had been for many weeks.
The commentary belied the gravity of the king's condition. He was dying of lung cancer. It was January the 31st, 1952. This would be the last time they would see each other. 6 days later, he was dead. The news reaching Elizabeth on safari in Kenya.
When we were there, it was this funny little sort of three-room shack balanced on the top of this giant fig tree. She'd gone up that ladder as a princess, and she came down the next morning very early as a queen because the king had died in the night. I think we were the last people in the world to know.
In June the following year, the coronation. Hundreds of thousands of people lined the route to Westminster Abbey. And at the beginning of the television age, more than 20 million watched the pageant at home.
Into the forecourt of the palace and through the gates comes the gilded coach, 2 centuries old, bearing the young queen to her crown. The huge wave of cheering travels with her, pouring along the mall as though it would lift her and carry her on her way.
Will you solemnly promise and swear to govern the people of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland?
I solemnly promise so to do.
Began her reign with a 6-month Commonwealth tour, the start of her biggest task, downsizing Britain's role in the world. She felt the Commonwealth should move away from ideas of empire and become more about friendship, equal rights between nations and races. She always felt strongly about it and being head of it.
When she became monarch, the Commonwealth was 8 nations, simply 8. And so the Queen and the Commonwealth, in a sense, they've grown up together. And you only have to see the Queen at a Commonwealth meeting to realise the affinity that exists.
Her value to Britain as a symbolic ambassador was incalculable. As well as hosting a few tyrants, Mugabe, Ceausescu, the Queen got to meet every American president bar Lyndon Johnson. She went riding with some, was winked at by others.
You helped our nation celebrate its bicentennial in 1976.
You're near, she says.
She gave me a look that only a mother could give a child.
Her reign coincided with great social change. Don't know what it is that makes me love you so.
Take
In the midst of the Silver Jubilee celebrations, the punk revolution, a time when some became less deferential about the monarchy, questioning its values. The Queen was delighted when Charles announced his engagement to Lady Diana Spencer. The public and the media entranced.
I'm amazed that she's been brave enough to take me on.
And I suppose in love.
Of course.
Whatever in love means.
The wedding was a global television event that put the monarchy's popularity at its peak. But increased media intrusion and the breakdown of the marriage, as with that of Andrew and Sarah Ferguson, was to profoundly wound the institution and shake the Queen herself.
The 1990s, really, we see the clash of the monarchy and the media. The tabloid newspapers were, you know, absolutely full of stories of the relationship breakdowns of Charles and Diana, Fergie and Andrew, the divorce of Princess Anne. It was all there. And this was really when the royal family imploded. And from being an asset, suddenly the royal family became toxic.
1992 was a year of crisis for the royal family. An intimate book was published about Diana's marriage to Charles. And then a fire broke out at the Queen's favourite home, Windsor Castle. It later cost £36 million to repair. And after public resistance to footing the bill, the Queen started to pay income tax for the first time.
1992 is not a year on which I shall look back with undiluted pleasure. In the words of one of my more sympathetic correspondents, it has turned out to be an annus horribilis.
When Diana was killed in a car crash in Paris, criticism of the royal family fell on the Queen herself. She had received the news at Balmoral. The family set off for church as usual that Sunday morning. But at the service, there was no mention of Diana. At Buckingham Palace, in accordance with protocol, no flag flew at half-mast. The Queen was not in residence. She remained in Scotland with her bereaved grandchildren, provoking strong criticism.
It was a difficult decision for them as to how to handle it. The immediate thought was, how do we protect these two young boys who have just lost their mother? And the immediate instinct, and I think this is a very human thing, is to circle the wagons and look after those boys. And I think that was the instinct of the Queen, Prince Philip, Prince Charles, and all the family up at Balmoral.
Under pressure to act and on advice from the Prime Minister, Tony Blair, the Queen returned to London and on the eve of the funeral gave the public what they wanted, a personal expression of grief.
What I say to you now, as your Queen and as a grandmother, I say from my heart. First, I want to pay tribute to Diana myself. She was an exceptional and gifted human being. In good times and bad, she never lost her capacity to smile and laugh, nor to inspire others with her warmth and kindness. I admired and respected her for her energy and commitment to others, and especially for her devotion to her two boys.
A few months later, the Queen and Prince Philip celebrated their golden wedding anniversary, and after a tough year, both uncharacteristically spoke openly about their lives together. Philip gave a rare insight into the qualities that made their royal marriage a happy union.
Of course, after 50 years of experience, I find there's a great temptation to give advice. The trouble is that no two marriages are quite alike. However, I think that the main lesson that we've learned is that tolerance is the one essential ingredient of any happy marriage. It may not be quite so important when things are going well, but it is absolutely vital when things get difficult. And you can take it from me that the Queen has the quality of tolerance and abundance.
In 2002, the Queen lost her only sibling, Princess Margaret. And then, just 7 weeks later, her mother. But despite the sadness, it was also a landmark year for the Queen, as 2002 marked her golden jubilee, 50 years on the throne. The combination of events led to an upsurge in support for the monarchy. The affection for her at an all-time high when she became the unexpected star of the opening ceremony of the 2012 London Olympics.
Good evening, Mr. Bond.
Good evening, Your Majesty.
After initially opposing Charles marrying Camilla Parker Bowles, the Queen eventually came round to the idea. It was a symbolic moment for the royal family, a time of reconciliation and forgiveness. The weddings of the Queen's grandsons seemed to herald a more open and younger-looking monarchy. When Prince William married Kate Middleton from outside the aristocracy, and then when Harry married Meghan Markle, these were some of the most watched events ever.
Meghan and Harry, it was going to be this great moment for the royal family, in which the royal family was going to change really revolutionarily and reflect really the multicultural society of Britain. And yet it didn't work out that way.
Meghan blamed the brutal treatment she was given by the British tabloids and lack of support from the royal family for her and Prince Harry's decision to step away from royal duties. The Queen herself was forced to intervene to remove Prince Andrew from his public roles, as the scandal that had started with his friendship with convicted sex offender Jeffrey Epstein grew. Turbulent times for the House of Windsor, just as Prince Philip, described by the Queen as her rock, was becoming ever more frail.
I'm speaking to you at what I know is an increasingly challenging time.
2020 brought the biggest global crisis of her long reign. Over 150,000 people in the UK died with coronavirus. People locked down at home to avoid spreading infection.
I want to thank everyone on the NHS front line, as well as care workers and those carrying out essential roles, who selflessly continue their day-to-day duties outside the home in support of us all.
Just as she'd done 80 years before, she addressed the nation.
We should take comfort that while we may have more still to endure, better days will return. We will be with our friends again. We will be with our families again. We will meet again.
When, at the age of 99, the Duke of Edinburgh died, the Queen lost the husband who had helped steer the royal family through all its storms. COVID restrictions on who could attend his funeral, illustrating just how very much alone she now was. The Platinum Jubilee marked her remarkable 70 years as monarch amidst national celebrations.
Your Majesty, Mummy, you have been there for us for these 70 years. You pledged to serve your whole life. You continue to deliver.
Tea?
And once again, she delivered a comic turn with a famous screen idol.
I do hope you're having a lovely jubilee.
At 96, she was seeming ever more frail and had to miss out on some of the long weekend of events. The core family surrounded her on the balcony, signalling a new, streamlined monarchy of the future. In a rare documentary in 1992, she reflected upon her role.
If you live in this sort of life, which people did very much,
You live very much by tradition and by continuity. You have to sort of work out in your own mind the hard work and then what you enjoy in retrospect from it, of the people you've met, like the small soldier who was giving a gallantry award to, and I said that was a very brave thing to do. Oh, he said it was just the training. And I have a feeling that in the end, probably, the training is the answer to a great many things. You can do a lot if you're properly trained. And I hope I have been.